Hi, now we'll move on to looking at setup system and then assemble system, and we'll probably finish up with the homework 3 template in 2D in this segment. All right, so let's look at the code. Here in setup system, it looks very, very similar to problem 1, or rather to homework 2, which was our first coding assignment. Slight differences here is that in node location, again, we have two indices. Again, the first is your global node number, just as before. But again, the column number now is which component of the position vector you want. Do you want the x component or the y component, or in 3D, the z component? Okay, we again call the define boundary conditions function. Resize our vectors and matrices. We define the quadrature rule. Again, you'll need to decide what quadrature rule you need. Is 2 enough? Do you need 3? Or more or less. Okay, so not a lot to do here in setup system, not much different from before. But now we'll move into assemble system. Okay, we have the same setup before, k equals 0, f equals 0, same constants, data types. We set up our element loop the same way. Again, we update the local DOF indices vector with element so that we can again relate our local degree of freedom numbering or local node numbering with the global node number. But now I've introduced these other objects. We have a full matrix called Jacobian, and then a double det J, which will hold the determinant of the Jacobian. Okay, the Jacobian you can see is of dimension dim by dim, or in this case a 2x2 matrix. It's the Jacobian for the mapping between the real domain and the biunit domain. All right. Remember, in the 1D case, we actually did have this Jacobian, but it was just a 1x1 matrix, essentially. It was HE over 2. All right, and so that showed up. That's how that showed up there. In this case, we have to create the matrix itself. Now, in the general case, elements aren't always going to be the same, and they aren't always going to be square. Or have nice right angle corners, like they are in this problem. And so I've kept the Jacobian general for that case. However, in our case, as you're checking your code, you may notice that the Jacobian is actually the same at every quadrature point in every element, and that it's actually a diagonal matrix. That's because of the uniformity of our mesh, okay? But in general, with an unstructured mesh, you wouldn't have the Jacobian being the same all over at each quadrature point. And it wouldn't necessarily be a diagonal matrix. Okay. Now, I actually, so in this first part, I have the same structure for defining F local. Again, we don't have Neumann boundary conditions, or at least we don't have non-zero Neumann boundary conditions, and we don't have any forcing function. So F local is actually 0 for this problem. However, I've left the structure there in case you wanted to include a forcing function. So it's there for you if you'd like. Again, all the structures there, you would still have to define what F local, what the 8th component of F local was, just as you did in the 1D problem. All right. Now for K local, I've also created a full matrix called Inv Jacobian, which will store the inverse of the Jacobian. And again, we need that. And I'll go into that a little bit more on the board in a second. I've also created this full matrix kappa, which will be our conductivity tensor. And in the assignment, it's already defined for you that it's a diagonal matrix with the value 385. Okay, so now let's look at k-local itself. And actually, before we get into that, again, k-local will use Jacobian. It uses the determinant of the Jacobian, which actually comes into play with the quadrature, numerical quadrature. And so that's where it will come into play. So let me look at the Jacobian for a second. Look at it in 2D, but it easily expands to 3D. Okay. So here's the Jacobian. It's in 2D. It's just the partial of x1 with respect to c1. Partial of x1 with respect to c2, Here, of course, x1 is x, x2 is y, if you're thinking of it that way. Partial of x2 with respect to c1, partial of x2 with respect to c2. Another way to put it more generally, we could say that the Jacobian of I, j is equal to the partial of x sub I with respect to c sub j. And of course that easily transfers over to 3D, to the 3D problem. Okay, now where do we actually need this? Well, of course we need the determinant of the Jacobian to do our numerical quadrature. Again, we saw the HE over 2 when we did quadrature in 1D. The HE over 2 was the determinant of the Jacobian. Okay, so that will show up again, and we'll see that in a second. Now, the other place it will show up is when we're doing our basis function gradients. Remember, when we defined the function basis gradient, it was the derivative with respect to xi, okay? Now, for k-local, let me just look at k-local AB. Something to point out first is we have this negative sign. I include the negative sign in the k-local so that when we're solving the actual system, we can still do d is equal to k inverse f. Okay, so I'm including the minus sign here. We have this integral over our xi domain. It's, in this case, it's a double integral, so I'll just include that here. We have our basis function A. Now it's the derivative. I'm going to write it out here. The derivative with respect to xi times kappa ij, and then the partial of b with respect to xj. Determinant of j. Sorry, the determinant of the j isn't necessarily with the numerical quadrature. It's with the change of domain, the change of indices from our real domain to our biunit domain. Just to clarify that. Dxi1, dxi2. All right, and I think this notation was used in the lecture. When you have this repeated index, there's an implied summation over I and j. Over I and j, and it's going from using our C++ notation would be 0 up to dim minus 1. Okay, so in this case, it's I will do a summation with I equals 0 and 1, and a summation with j equals 0 and 1. All right, but now this term here, or rather both of these terms, these are the gradients with respect to the real domain, but we only have the gradient with respect to the biunit domain. So if we look at this first term, and of course it applies to the second as well, the partial of Na with respect to Xi is equal to, using the chain rule, partial of Na with respect to Xi1 times the partial of Xi1 with respect to xi, plus partial of na with respect to xi2 times the partial of xi2 with respect to, again, xi. So you can see that these are very close to what we have up here. Of course, the little I and the big I doesn't, it's just an index. Except that these terms come from the inverse. So this term here would be the Jacobian inverse, and it would be component 2i, for example. Okay, so that's why in the code over here, after we found the Jacobian i, And you can see that we've done that using an interpolation here of the node locations of x times the basis gradients. Okay, once we've defined the Jacobian, we come out. Notice this is all within our quadrature loop here. Okay, since it's 2D, we're looping over the quadrule in two directions. And at each quadrature point, we evaluate the Jacobian, then take the determinant, this Jacobian.determinant, that's a function related to the DL2 full matrix class. Okay, so we can do that. And also associated with it, there's this function dot invert. So we can get our inverse Jacobian. Okay. So now this term here I could actually write as a summation as well. Let me write that on the next slide just so we have a little more room. So the partial of A, NA with respect to X, I, would actually be the product NA with respect to C, I'll do a little I, times the partial of C little I with respect to XI. And again, there's an implied summation here. It's the same as summing over I equals 0 up to less than dim. Okay. Writing that summation in, again, wasn't necessarily because since there is the repeated index here, there's an implied summation over the index I. All right. So now if we look back at our code here, I've set up several different for loops. We have for loops over A and B, which of course correspond to the components of K-local. We have a for loop over capital I, and capital J, which of course are these capital I's and capital J's. And then a for loop over the little I and little J's, which are the I's and J's that we saw in this notation here. All right. So, but now again, you will have to decide what is that integrand going to be? So you'll set that up using, of course, quadrature, the quadrature rules, including the quadrature rate, the quadrature weights, and of course you'll use the inverse Jacobian and the determinant of the Jacobian because of the bi-unit domain. Okay. You will still need to do the assemble system portion of this function, but it will be exactly the same as the assembling the system in the previous homework template. We apply Dirichlet boundary conditions the exact same way DL2 will do it. Solve is exactly the same as its output results. Okay, so again, the biggest portion that is different, or that you'll have to be working on in this template is again within assemble system and the basis functions themselves, as well as defining your boundary conditions. Okay, so that wraps it up for the 2D template. In the next segment, we'll quickly go over the coding template for the 3D problem on homework 3.